And Pastor is back, and he wants to video everything and upload it on the website. So all of what we do today will be available, Lord willing, to people who can't see things that are going on. And we want to start. If you're on the internet, you can see our little program. We start at 9:40. We're 2 minutes after that right now. And Brother Ron Toll has joined us for Sabbath School and church today. And he has graciously agreed to share some things, special things from nature. I think about something we all have. And it's time for us to do that now. I'm going to move the mic over to where he is. Good morning, yeah. Brother Ron.
Today we're going to talk about fingernails. Look at your hands and see your fingernails. What do you think they're there for? To protect your fingers is a very good answer. Not just for scratching your head, huh?
Okay, come on.
Are you Benjamin?
This is Benjamin, and this is Ron Toll. He's sharing some nature.
Glad to meet you. Now I have another one here that I want you to look at. What do you think that comes from?
The cat or something.
No. It comes from a black bear. Now, if you look at that, what is it used for? They use it for climbing. They use it for digging. They use it for protection. That's right, Ashley. They use it for protection. And they also use it to tear logs and stuff apart so they can get food. They don't need it for eating berries and grasses and stuff, but they do need it for lots of other things. We have another one here. Long and slender. Where do you think that comes from?
Cat.
No. He's a digger. It's used for digging
badger.
The first time I met a badger, I was along probably from here to the pastor's house away from it, and I could see dirt flying. Badgers are the best diggers that there are in the world. They can dig like you cannot believe. And you put five or six of these together, you can see where they could get into the dirt and just rake it away. Now here's another one. It's a little shorter and a little broader. What do you think it comes from? No. It comes from a beaver. He also digs, but look what he digs into. He digs into the mud. He doesn't dig into the hard dirt like what a badger does. So it doesn't have to be as long and sharp and pointed. But he also uses this to fill up the holes between the logs and stuff with his dam. And also uses it to hold his food when he's chewing on the little limbs and everything. Now you mentioned a coyote or a dog. This is what they look like. They don't have very big long claws. Of course, about the only thing they use it for is a little bit of digging and a scratching themselves. Now, we have another one here.
That's a cat one.
That's a cat one. That comes from a bobcat. And you can see that it's very round and pointed. And it's used for climbing. You can see how it would go into the trees and stuff very readily. And they also use it to grasp their food when they're catching rabbits and animals. Now here's another one that's much smaller, but it has basically the same shape.
A bird?
No, this is from a raccoon. He's also a climber. You can see the same shape almost as what the bobcat one was. And they use it to climb trees and everything, but they are much smaller than what the bobcat, so their claws can be much smaller. Now here's one, I'm going to throw you a curve. What do you think that one's from?
An eagle.
A what?
Eagle.
Very good. That is an eagle claw. And you can see it's long and sharp and pointed. And it comes, they need it to catch the fish as they go into the stream and grab it, you know. Three toes forward and one toe back.
Also hold on to branches.
And hold on to branches and stuff, yes. Now, these are some that are very readily, but you also need to think about a deer. His hoof has turned into, his hoof is turned into a fingernail. They have the hoof, and it's a cloven hoof, too wide. The horse has only one. And rhinoceros has three toenails. Why do you think he has three?
So he can run faster.
Well, that's part of it, but he's also walking in water, and if he bumps his foot or something, that toenail is there to protect so it doesn't bruise. Elephant has five, believe it or not. Now, we look at the creation and we see that God created all these animals in 24 hours, basically, one day, or so it says in the Bible. And to me, it is simply amazing that He can create all these animals in that period of time. But you look deeper into it, they all have different tails, they all have different fingernails, they all have different ears. Look at all the different items that He has changed to put into all these animals. And we take a lot of that for granted. Mm-hmm. We just see a bear. We don't see little round ears and a little short tail and big claws, you know. We just see the bear itself. But that's what I wanted to show you, is how specific He's created all these animals.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing, Brother Ron. I appreciate that and all of these different claws. Fingernails. Okay, thank you. Now we want to move over and move right into our lesson because I have a science demonstration that I'm going to watch on with Becky. Thank you, Ron. A science demonstration that both of you can help me with. And we want to get to that. We might talk about cacti. We might, if we have time, I have a couple quizzes. One is a Who Am I quiz. I know Ashley likes that. Then we have different versions of the Bible that we want to look at, how it describes the Sabbath and what we should be doing on the Sabbath. And our lesson is going to be right up here. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Sabbath School. We're talking about the Sabbath, and there's a special rest on the Sabbath. And we want to move to slide 2, just a moment while I get my slides pulled up. The seventh day, and slide 2. And on the seventh day, God ended His work which He had made, and He rested on the seventh day. Does it say He rested on the Sabbath day? It says He rested on the seventh day. Next slide. What work had God been doing from which He rested? Benjamin and Ashley, help me figure this out. What work had He been doing? Well, He had just been creating, but how did He create? He spoke. That's not all He did, but let's go down through the list. He said, let there be light, let there be a firmament, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together, let the dry land appear, let the earth bring forth grass and herbs and fruit trees. He said all that. That's pretty hard work, isn't it? Is it hard work to speak, Ashley? Oh, no, she likes to just talk away. It's not hard at all. But somehow, when God said it, it happened. Next slide. But He also, He said, let there be lights in the firmament. He said, let the waters spring forth. the moving creature, the fowl in the open firmament. He said, let the earth bring forth the living creature, the cattle, the creeping thing, the beast.
Aww.
And then he said, let us make man in our image. He said all of those things. Next slide. But God also did a couple of other things. He formed man. What did he form man from?
The
dust of the ground. And this is for the adults that are listening. They might appreciate this word. Hebrew word form is yatsah. And it means to fashion, like a potter would with clay. That's how God made man. He took the dust. He fashioned it just like a potter. That's what forming means. And then it also says God made a woman. Genesis 2:22. And this Hebrew word is bana. And it means to build. Now, why Moses used all of these different words? He spoke. That's what happened. He formed. God was a potter. And he made Adam. And then he made woman. But he didn't form woman according to Moses. He built woman for some reason. And I don't understand it all. I'm just sharing what I've learned. Next slide. Moses used four words to describe God's work of creating. He used bara in the beginning. He created the heaven and earth. Remember Genesis 1:1. So we have this Hebrew word bara, which means he created. And that simply just means, like we say today, create. And then when he said, let there be, that Hebrew word is amar, A-M-A-R. And that means to speak or to command. So God created in the beginning. He spoke all these things. Then when he made something, it's a different Hebrew word, asa, A-S-A-H, sorry, which simply means to make. And then yatsar, when he formed. So all of this, Moses, I hope you understand or beginning to understand that Moses was a great writer. And he didn't just use one word for create or one word to make. He used different words to help you understand what God was doing during this first week on our earth. Things the Bible says, next slide, that God created. He created the heaven and the earth. It also says about the whales and every living thing in the water. He said he created those. He didn't form those. He didn't build those. He didn't necessarily speak those, although he spoke it into existence. But Moses also says he created those things. He created every winged fowl. He created man. In fact, Genesis 2:3 says he created all this world. So all of this business of creating involved forming, fashioning like a potter, building, speaking. It was a great work that God did. Next slide. The things God commanded or spoke into existence, I'm just reviewing, light, firmament. We've been through all that. We're going to go to the next slide because we have much to do. Slide number 9. Then the things that God made. There are several things that Moses says God made. There are several things Moses said God spoke into existence. There are some things, next slide, that he formed, man and every beast. Next slide. Now Psalms 148:5 says, let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded and they were created. Before we leave Creation Week, I hope Ashley and Benjamin and everyone who's listening can understand better this great work of creation he did. He spoke, he formed, he built, he created. All of that went together day by day into everything we have on this earth. And so it is only right we praise the name of the Lord for all that he has done, for he commanded. Next slide. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him, for he spake. And it was done. He commanded, and it stood still. The Sabbath was hallowed at the creation. God saw everything that he had made, and it was very good. And he rested in the joy of what he had done. So all of his work, even the little fingernails we see on all the creatures on us, all of this he put together in those 7 days of, 6 days of creation. And on the seventh day, God looked at what he had done. And Ellen White says, he rested in the joy of his completed work. We should stand in awe. We can't even begin to touch the tip of the iceberg of what he's done. What we see is so magnificent, but what we need to use a microscope for is there too, and it's beautiful in how it all works. He was joyful with what he done. He gave to Adam as a day of rest. He gave the seventh day. It was to be a memorial of his creation and a sign of his power and his love. Next slide. The Sabbath calls our thoughts to nature, to the song of the bird, the sighing of the trees. I don't know about you, but I like a breeze. And we wouldn't have a breeze if it hadn't been for that firmament that he put between heaven, above heaven, where the birds fly, where the air is there for us to breathe. That's where the sighing of the trees comes forth, the music of the sea. I don't know if you like to be at the ocean, but I do. And the ocean has that wonderful sound as each wave comes in. We may still hear the voice who talked with Adam and Eve in the cool of the day. Now, he wants us to enjoy his Sabbath day, to appreciate his creation. So I'm going to ask Benjamin and Ashley, what's your favorite part of nature? Of all these things that he created day after day, in the heavens, in the ocean, on the land, what is your favorite part? Any ideas?
Probably the leaves on the trees, because just looking at the detail and the texture of the leaves.
Yeah, the leaves. And every leaf, every tree has its own design to a leaf. Ashley?
The animal.
What animal in particular? That's a hard decision.
Well, there's seven, but I like how the gels make different everything, what they do.
Oh, it's all beautiful. We'll never tire of it. And that's just what we see on this earth. If you are faithful and ready to meet Jesus when he comes, we have a whole universe to explore. Other planets, heaven itself. This is just peanuts almost here. And I don't want to degrade what Jesus has done here and what our Heavenly Father has done. It's wonderful. Even though it's marred by sin, but we have great things to look forward to. And you know, I was, when I taught Sabbath School years ago, I had a guest speaker come in. And I asked that guest speaker, what is it that you are looking forward to most when you get to heaven? And this person was a musician, so you know what this person said? Hearing things and sounds that I've never heard before. And, you might be looking forward to, when you get to heaven, seeing things you never saw before. There'll be trees. You'll be able to see the leaves, Benjamin, on the tree of life. And there'll be leaves there that you can't even imagine. See things we've never seen before. Hear things we've never heard before. Probably feel things we've never felt before, etc. Taste things. Can you imagine the grace? The size of a cluster of grapes, everything is so diminished here on this earth. Things are going to be wonderful when we get to heaven. So, they say, Benjamin said leaves, Ashley said animals. Next slide, we're into the mountains. Your favorite part, or where would you like most to be on Sabbath after church? I didn't ask you this, so I have to ask you. If you could go anywhere after our services today, where would you like to go? Anybody have an answer? I mean, it doesn't have to be West Virginia. It could be somewhere.
Yellowstone.
Ashley says Yellowstone.
What would you say?
You would, pardon me, Benjamin and Ashley would both like to go to Yellowstone.
So it's a great place.
Now, maybe, next slide, maybe it would be in the mountains. Next slide, we're just going to quickly go through some pictures of mountains. Yeah, let's try the next slide. Pretty mountains. Yeah, they're both of these young people are saying, I want to be there. Next slide, some more. This is Yellowstone. Pastor would be able to tell us what falls that is at Yellowstone.
Yellowstone Falls.
Yellowstone Falls. Okay, that's slide 21 is Yellowstone Falls. Next slide is a volcano. I don't know how close you'd want to get to a volcano, but I put it in because it's interesting. Next slide. Maybe you'd like to go to the ocean, like me. Next slide, a beautiful picture of the waves coming up on the beach. Next slide, another picture of ocean. I mean, if you didn't have to worry about the stinging things in the water or drowning in the water, I think you all would probably like to just cruise.
The Dead Sea or something. Right. Float.
Slide 26, the beautiful, this is just one of all the many beautiful fish that God has created. Next slide, 27, is just a secluded cove. Yeah, that would be nice to be there too. What about it? Next slide. What about a flower garden? I don't know if everyone likes flowers, but the colors are beautiful. This is a fuchsia. And here's, next slide, is mountain laurel. Just the delicate way God has created the petals of the mountain laurel. It's beautiful. Next slide, some roses.
I like that.
Next slide, some rhododendron. Next slide, some pretty pansies. Next slide is a beautiful flower garden from Holland. Next slide is the delicate lily of the valley. Ashley likes these flowers. She likes to go out in the field and collect flowers. Next slide is maybe you have your own flower garden at home that you would like to enjoy. Maybe you'd rather be near a lake or a river. How about this one from Thailand? Nice blue water. How about this one? A warm lake. Okay, well, you find that at Yellowstone, but that'd be pretty hot there. Okay, next slide. Maybe you'd like to be with the animals. And here we have a mighty lion. Next slide. He's a cute little, I'm not sure.
Chimpanzee,
Ashley says. Okay, next slide. Some tigers. And you see, in heaven, we won't have to worry about being harmed by them. They'll be just as friendly as little Annie is and love to play just like that little tiger kitten does. Next slide. Or maybe you like these kind of creatures because they're so cute and pretty and delightful if they're not poison frogs, of course. Or maybe you'd like to be with the birds. And this is one of my favorite because I like parrots.
You wouldn't want to be with those in real life.
Not in real life, Ashley says, because of their hook bills.
No.
What?
Not because of that, because those type of parrots have the noisiest
call. Oh, they're noisy.
It's really high pitched.
Okay. Anyway, they're sweet to look at. Next slide is kind of cute too. I think these are penguins.
Those are penguins.
Yes. Next slide. One of the most beautiful birds that God has created, a peacock. Next slide. This is a common little robin with her nest.
We had a nest of those in the orchards.
We had a nest, Ashley says, in our little orchard. Maybe you like owls. Or maybe you like beautiful ducks. Just look at the handiwork of God's creation of the feathers and the coloration. Maybe you like eagles. There's that hook there, or that.
You can see the talons down there?
Okay, and those are her chicks. What about little ducks? There's something really cute about a little duck. Maybe you'd like to be in the snow. I don't know about the rest of you, but I know Ashley would.
Only if you have a coat.
Only with your coat, right. And our story later on in church is about James White who traveled in the snow. But about snow, kids really like, don't you think? Yeah, snowballs, okay. Yeah, here's the next slide is a snowy sunset or sunrise, I'm not sure which. Or maybe next slide you'd like to just play on the grass like Annie does. And there's next slide is a prettier one. You could be out under the trees running and playing. I know the kids
are, be nice
both of them are smiling.
Won't it be nice in heaven? Probably will be weeds in the grass and stuff.
No weeds in the grass, Ashley says, in heaven, and we can enjoy the fields. Next slide, Benjamin mentioned the leaves. Maybe you'd like to go for a walk under the trees. Look at those beautiful trees. Wouldn't you like to walk down that path? And next slide is a bunch of, a forest, of course, by a lake or a river during the fall.
Now, if that was a nice hot lake or a warm lake,
you would be happy if it was warm. If you're warm-blooded, Ashley, you'll live, right? Okay. Next slide, or maybe you would like to be under the stars, looking up at this next slide, starry heavens. There's so much.
I'd like to be.
Oh, both of these kids would like to be.
Fly in the sky.
And in heaven, that's something you can look forward to. Wherever you are, you will be learning about God. Whatever part of nature, by the ocean, in the woods, wherever you are, you'll be learning about God just as surely as you learn about Him, next slide, in His Word. And when you go into the great outdoors, Ashley and Benjamin, look for the Fibonacci patterns that we talked about last time. Or take a magnifying glass or loop and look at things that your naked eye can't see. You'll be amazed. If you do that with a leaf, like Benjamin likes, or flowers, or take paper and crayons and do leaf rubbings, or bark rubbings, or take a paper bag and collect things that are connected to Bible stories that you can share later. So we've done that in the past, and I might pull out a stick and ask, what does this stick remind you of in the Bible? You have to think about that story.
The Elisha and
the... Right. Okay, so you could take a bag and collect some things that you can tell a story with later on. You can listen for new sounds, especially in the summer and in the evening and at night. There are all kinds of different sounds for creatures who live during the day, come out at night. You might look for different colors that God has created. There's much you can do in nature. And on the seventh day, this day of rest that God has given us, it's to help us remember this mighty work of creation. The seventh day isn't just a day for us to lay back and snooze because we've worked hard all week long. It's given to us that we might spend time with our Creator. And one of the best ways is
out in nature.
Now, His written word is important too, and that's why it's important not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, to open God's word and to learn about it. That's important. It's probably more important because it gives us a guidebook about the times that we're facing. But His work in nature helps us to love Him more. It helps us to appreciate how powerful He is. So this day, this seventh day, is to be cherished and treasured. And we don't do any work on that day because we want to spend it with God and learn about Him. He's worthy. Remember several slides back, the text, He spoke and it stood still. He commanded and it stood still. He is powerful and worthy. What did you want to say, Ashley?
I just wanted to ask, what is your definition of work?
Work?
Because the scientific definition of work is...
force.
Yeah, your movement and force. So, if you, like picking up your Bible or something, that's what the scientific definition of work is. I'm just wondering what it is.
Okay, well, it's not the scientific definition. Benjamin, I'll get back to that. Benjamin wanted to share too.
If you take the Bible, the B-I-B-L-E, if you spell out its basic instructions before leaving Earth.
That's right, Benjamin. Thanks for reminding me. And that's why the Bible is so important. If we had, we need that more probably than a tree and a flower, although all of that is a gift to us to help us know how much God loves us. But as far as work is concerned, what the Bible is talking about is physical work. Things that we could do 6 days that we don't have to do. In fact, even taking our baths can be done before the Sabbath. Getting our clothes ready for Sabbath is to be done before the holy Sabbath hours. Anything we can do beforehand must be done, because God expects this day for us to walk with Him in a special way. Remember, He came to Adam and Eve and walked in the cool of the garden and conversed with them. He wants to do the same with us. They are dinosaurs. There we are. I promised to do the science demonstration because it will be fun. It's about creation also in a special way. But I have a question. Tell me, were dinosaurs created during the week of creation? In other words, did God create dinosaurs? What do you think? You might think this is a trick question, but just tell me what you think, and then we'll figure it out as we go along.
Well, it's part of the land animals.
It was Benjamin says it was a land animal, okay? What do you think?
I'll agree with that.
You agree with that. Well, dinosaurs, exclamation mark, at creation. So let's move on to the next slide. I'm going to tell you right now, I don't know that I have all the answers, but we can't live Creation Week without first thinking about at least dinosaurs. Well, let me ask you this. Do we know for sure that dinosaurs existed?
Yeah.
They're not living today. We don't have any dinosaurs today. So how do we know?
Some people say lizards are dinosaurs.
Someone say lizards.
People say lizards are the same thing.
Lizards, some people say lizards are dinosaurs, but both of you would agree that dinosaurs existed at some time. How do we know?
Because there's evidence.
What kind of evidence?
Fossils.
Fossils.
Okay, there are bones everywhere. Yes, Ashley?
And we can't say that dinosaurs don't exist now, because
All right, Ashley. Pardon me. I'm not scientifically minded at this time. So I, and the rest of you who are listening have to realize she's studying this right now, science. Okay. But nevertheless, what Benjamin said is true. We have fossil evidence of dinosaurs. And it's not just in one place. If you think of the letter A, for example, Asia, Africa, America, Australia, Antarctic, these places, all of them have, I don't know if it's Arctic or Antarctic, so
Antarctica.
Antarctica. Okay, all of these places have dinosaur beds where fossils are prevalent. Thousands of them sometimes. And in Montana, where you live, there are dinosaur beds. Even in Billings, but I'm not sure what they have in Billings right now. I know that scientists went there to research and then they ended up somewhere else. And Benjamin's from Billings, that's why I add that. But dinosaur fossils are everywhere. So we know they existed, but I have to tell you that some people say, oh, well, Satan just did all that. God didn't do that. But let's look at this first slide. Do you know what dinosaur that is?
T-Rex.
Tyrannosaurus Rex. Does he look like a friendly creature?
No.
Not at all. Next slide. There's another slide of a dinosaur. Next slide. Is another one?
A smaller one,
and I should tell you that not all dinosaurs were T-Rex, that huge. Maybe 80% of them were 8 feet or smaller. So only 20% basically is what they think today are huge dinosaurs. Slide number 6 is a trick question. Is that a dinosaur? What do you think? Yes,
no,
just
no.
Say yes or no. You're right, Benjamin. It's a woolly mammoth. And people get that confused. Some people might say it's a dinosaur, but really it's a woolly mammoth. Slide number 7 are some dinosaur tracks. Slide number 8 is a dinosaur that's put together in a museum in England.
That's one of those.
That's one of those really big ones.
They're called, but they eat like at the top of trees and stuff like that.
Uh-huh, okay. Slide number 9 is an artist's rendition of some of the dinosaurs. Slide number 10 is another rendition of some of them. Slide number 11 gives you a comparison of man with some of the smaller ones. Slide number 12 is one of the rare fossils of a winged dinosaur. It's harder to find a fossil that shows the wings like that one does. Slide number 13. Now we're going to talk about them. First, we're going to start with spiritual gifts, volume 3, page 75. Every species of animal which God had created were preserved in the ark. Were dinosaurs preserved in the ark?
No.
How do we know? Ashley says no. How do we know?
No.
Because there's nothing. Now, I should tell you that all the fossils that we have are in beds left over by the flood. The water receded and all the fossils have settled into beds. We know they're dated to the time of the flood. But we have no fossils for dinosaurs in any layer of fossil layer after the flood. So the dinosaurs were destroyed at the flood and they weren't on the ark because we have no fossils that date after the flood. Does that make sense to you? Do you understand what I'm saying? The confused species.
13.
On slide 13. Every species of animal which God had created were preserved in the ark. The confused species which God did not create. So there were some things God didn't create, but somehow they got together, and we call that amalgamation. You see here, which were the result of amalgamation were destroyed by the flood. Next slide, 14. Amalgamation is a big word which just means combining. And when you think about dinosaurs, does that make sense to you now, Benjamin?
I get it now.
You get it now. Because this amalgamation means a combining, a confused species which God did not create. That means Satan was behind it. And just think about a T-Rex. Would you want to live with a T-Rex next door to you?
Only if it was friendly.
Well, but those jaws, were they really friendly? They look like violent, ferocious creatures. And I'm not saying that I have the answers, but Ellen White says there was a confused species from amalgamation that did not get on the ark. Next slide. The typical dinosaur anatomy is a combination of the characteristics of several classes, including reptiles, birds, and mammals. Does that make sense to you? It's like a mixture of qualities of this and qualities of that. The dinosaurs, along with many other extinct vertebrates, such as marine reptiles, flying reptiles, mammal-like reptiles, appear to be amalgamations of the characteristics of different classes of vertebrates. And this is from David C. Neal, who wrote a book, Dinosaurs, an Adventist View. Next slide. There are no remains of dinosaurs, pterosaurs, or mammal-like reptiles in any layer of rock deposited after the flood. We're going to move on. Slide 17 is another depiction of these creatures. Now, we live, Ashley and I, and here in Smyrna Valley, with lots of woods around us. I drive down the highway through areas that have no houses, no businesses. It's just nature. And I was thinking as I was coming down here, how would I feel if a T-Rex was living in those woods beside the road as I was driving? My car wouldn't protect me. A tank wouldn't protect me against a T-Rex. Now, if this is true, that these dinosaurs were amalgamations that Satan was behind, and the people who lived before the flood put together with their with their intelligence, it would have to be with gene splicing, etc. And if I lived in an era of that happening, where my life was exposed to these huge creatures, I would be in terror. And today, looking back on what probably occurred, but I can't say for sure, I can understand why God had to put an end to all of that. Because they were creating, if this is true, huge T-Rexes, which couldn't be controlled by man because of their size. And I'm angry that such a creature was created and that God had to put an end to it. He had to clean the world up. And the only people that he was able to save was Noah and his family, although the ark was open to anyone who wanted to step inside. But if you think about having to live next door to these types of creatures, you can understand why God said, I have to put an end to this. Go ahead, Benjamin.
There's a saying, you can run, but you can't hide. Mm-hmm. That implies that. Mm-hmm.
That's right. Soon after, slide 18, soon after the flood, the race began to rapidly decrease in size and in length of years. There was a class of very large animals which perished at the flood. God knew that the strength of man would decrease, and these mammoth animals could not be controlled by feeble man. This is different than the amalgamation. If you study it out, it seems to me there were these confused species, but then there were these very large animals that God knew man couldn't deal with.
What, like the mammoths?
I don't know, because we have mammoth fossils that date after the flood. So all of this, I don't have all the answers, but it's something we can consider and at least know that there was a species or plural species of creatures that were amalgamated that God did not take on the ark. Okay, now we want to do our science demonstration. We're going to go now floating on air. The text we want to use has to do with this creature. It floats on air for hours at a time. What is it? Eagles float on air. And the text that goes with this, but they that wait upon the Lord, you know this text?
Mm-hmm.
Shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Isaiah 40, verse 31. Now, here's another picture. This is a hawk, I think. Right. Or no.
That's a golden eagle.
That's a golden eagle, yes, you're right. Eagles can fly with no apparent effort. They will soar for hours on thermals, rising currents of warm air. Likewise, Christians have invisible support from on high. God will be with us during the high times of soaring and also during the low times of testing. And we'll just quickly go through those pictures. And now what we need is a hairdryer and a balloon or a lightweight ball. So one of you can take a balloon and one of you can take a ping pong ball. A ball, maybe you've seen this in some science museums. A ball can be suspended permanently by a stream of moving air. This is called the Bernoulli effect. The air pressure within the stream is smaller than the air pressure on the outside of the item. The greater outside air pressure pushes inward on the ball from all sides, thus suspending it in moving air. Whenever the ball begins to leave the airstream, the higher pressure puts it down. Now I have a hairdryer here. And for those of you, if you didn't know anything, if I put something here and turn it on, what do you think the air would do to whatever I put in here?
And
blow it off, right? Blow it off. That's what you would think. So I'm going to start with this thing. I have a ping pong ball. So when I put it here, it should blow it out. Out, right?
I keep going in the shoe.
Well, what are we going to do? You see, it's going in place. Now, if I... the reason it's staying in place is that there's air going underneath it, but also air going around it. Or there's the air around it that's holding in place. The air is pressing this up, but the pressure on all sides of it is greater than that, and it's holding it in place. If the air pressure out here in this room were less than the pressure that's blowing it up, it would just keep going until it fell down. Now, I'm going to turn this on. We're going to let Benjamin see what happens with the balloon.
Okay.
I put another ball in.
You go for it. Let Benjamin try that one. Put another ball in.
No.
Okay. Now, did you know that if we didn't have a firmament, that couldn't happen? It couldn't happen without this firmament that God has created. We need the firmament to get air and to live, but also this couldn't happen. We couldn't move air. Now, the same thing happens.
How could it walk around if you can't move
air? You could put cotton here. You could put a wad of paper here. If you had a strong enough air mover or blower, you could suspend a screwdriver. It has to be stronger, though, of course. Objects remain suspended as long as that airstream is active. Stop the flow, and your object will fall. In the same way, an eagle couldn't soar if the firmament wasn't there, if the pressure wasn't there. And it's the same way with an airplane. And Pastor maybe would have time to explain how an airplane takes off. I have slide 15. And if you want to trade places with me,
I'll go ahead and let you finish it.
Okay. Well, all right, but slide 15 shows a jet plane. And those jets, now I could be wrong, Pastor, so you'll have to correct me. But those jets, if you guys want to go around and see now, well, you don't need to stand here with me, but you can if you want. But those engines give the propulsion to that jet to take off. But finally it gets enough energy. Next slide. That the pressure will lift the airplane. The pressure under the wings will lift the airplane, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But the airplane wing is shaped in a way, it's not just like a board. It has a curve on the top. And why does it have a curve on the top?
To change the speed of the airflow so that you'll actually have more air flowing fast. It actually has to fly faster over the wing. And so you have more pressure underneath and less pressure on the top. And that's like a vacuum. When you have a vacuum, it sucks something toward the source of the vacuum. So it creates almost like a vacuum effect on the top of the wing.
Uh-huh.
And it's pulling the airplane
yes.
up.
Yes, and so, okay, and all of this happens because of the firmament God has made. And here the next slide shows some of the apparatus on the wing to slow it down when it comes in for a landing. Changes the airflow. Next slide.
Nose fly.
And why do we have a tail? Whatever called of this part.
The horizontal or the vertical stabilizer. There's two.
Oh, I see. It's a stabilizer.
Well, the thing that makes the T at the top, is that the one you're thinking
mm-hmm.
about?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, that changes the angle of attack of the airplane so that the wing hits the air at a slightly different angle to create more or less lift.
Or whatever. Okay.
Yes.
Winged flight, slide 19, is not possible on the moon because there is no air there and therefore no pressure differences.
And on Mars either.
And also, do you know that a frisbee, the way a frisbee works and it can go through the air, it's all because of the firmament. If the firmament weren't there, you couldn't do that.
No.
That's
how about
right.
A boomerang?
The what?
Probably a boomerang.
And the boomerang is the same way. And so I want you to appreciate what God has done just by creating a firmament. Not only does it give us the oxygen and the other little inert things that we breathe that we need, but it allows the bird if the firmament wasn't there, the birds couldn't fly because there's no air for them to work in. Now, how many of you know Isaiah 40, verse 31 in music? They that wait upon the Lord. Okay, Isaiah 40, verse 31.
They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Teach me, Lord, to wait.
Thank you. Now, what does it mean to wait on the Lord?
Be patient.
To be patient. It also means because we wait, we're trusting God to work everything out. We're waiting on Him. He doesn't have the same time schedule we have, so we wait on Him. Okay, so let's have prayer. Let's close with prayer, and you'll have to forgive me for not kneeling because I have a knee problem. Father, we're so thankful for all that you've created. You spoke. And it occurred. And you did this because you love us. You've given us so many things to understand how great you are, how powerful, how creative you are. But it's all because you love us. Help us to love you back and to show our love by our obedience. And please help each one of us to be ready for Jesus when He comes, I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, thank you one and all for joining us.
Thank you.
And we hope that you will be with us next Sabbath when we have some more things to share. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.